to Leslie Kaminoff. Welcome to Kiki TV. Leslie, I'm so glad that you're here today. Leslie is bringing more than 40 years of yoga knowledge, yoga experience, and so much study and sharing. And I really wanted to, I'm so happy that you agreed to sit down with me. And I really just wanted to look at what is modern yoga coming out of the West, and how did we get to where we are, and what were influences in some leading movements of yoga coming out of New York and California in the last 30, 40 years that has shaped probably international yoga today. That's my thesis. You know, viewers can disagree. You can disagree. So Leslie, you started yoga.
1978.
You're an OG.
So I fit in that, you know, 40 year time span. Right. Plus a little, yeah.
And you were in California at that time?
No, I was in New York. I got sent to California by the Shivananda Group in 1981. But I did my first yoga class at the Shivananda Center on 24th Street in 1978 at the invitation of my father, actually, who was taking classes there. He was dealing with kind of a midlife crisis of his own and using things like yoga and psychotherapy and meditation and running, marathon running, to turn his life around. And so it was actually his invitation that brought me to my first yoga class. And that would have been when I was 20 years old.
Amazing. So when we came into yoga, I would say I was introduced to yoga in 1981 through my studies at New York University in theater. And that very, you know, few people knew about yoga at that time, but probably the most influential yoga in those 70s, early 80s was the Shivananda yoga. Today,
in terms of the numbers of yoga teachers they trained, certainly. I mean, the first wide-scale training of yoga teachers with a sort of a set month-long program, you could definitely point to Shivananda. Integral had its own training programs as well. But in terms of the volume of teachers trained, I think you'd have to give that one to Shivananda.
So, and I think, but I do think that we would have to tell people today, well, what the heck is Shivananda yoga and what was integral yoga? Because these influential schools and programs have been eclipsed by other influences. So, how would you?
Well, in a sense, actually, the time frame you're talking about is interesting because it's when the sort of Vedanta influenced way that yoga had been taught in the West for about 100 years since Vivekananda introduced Vedanta in 1893 at the World Parliament of Religions in Chicago. 1893. You know, the main viewpoint that was behind the yoga that was being taught, the hatha yoga that was being taught, was very much influenced by Vedanta. And that's evidenced by the fact that, you know, integral and Shivananda yoga, those were started by swamis, both of whom were students of Swami Shivananda. But there were also flourishing Vedanta societies in the States for many years prior to that and so on. But the time frame you're talking about is sort of when the householders took over from the swamis, if you think about it. Because when we look at the influences that came from Krishnamacharya, right, who was a householder, his teacher, Sri Rama Mahana Brahmachari, was a householder, Patabi Joyce householder, Iyengar householder, Desikachar householder. Yeah, these were all people with families, with wives, with children. They were not, you know, renunciates. Yeah, yeah. They had to earn a living, right? And so, but more importantly, I would say the philosophical underpinnings were different because they went to Patanjali primarily. And that's treating yoga as its own darshana, as its own point of view philosophically with its own metaphysics, whereas Vedanta was actually borrowing yoga practices and all of that to promote its philosophy, which of course was behind the swamis. You know, when you take, I was a swami, by the way, with Shivananda. So I don't know if you knew
learned that.
That
recently.
Yeah. Yes. Right. So you're actually, you know, you're part of a religious order when you're a swami, and the underlying view of the universe is that of Vedanta. So Americans or Westerners in general had been receiving their hatha yoga with a healthy dose of Hinduism, actually. Whereas, you know, Iyengar, Patavi Joyce, Desikachar very much made a distinction between the Hindu aspects that had become attached to yoga and the yoga itself. And so the time frame we're talking about in the last 40 or so years, I would say you'd have to say that's when the householders kind of took over the narrative from the swamis to some extent.
Yes, and interestingly, people used to ask, you know, Patavi Joyce, you know, should we, you know, take Ganesha? Should we take, you know, Krishna? And he'd be like, you have your own God. You keep your own God. Give us a mantra. Yeah. And he'd be like, you have your own prayer. You have your own God. You take this yoga practice every day, every day, every day for mind control, for chitta vritti nirodha. You take this yoga. Don't worry. Everything's going to work out. So
are we saying practice and all is coming anymore, or has that become a verboten phrase?
You know, I don't know if I ever heard him actually say practice and all is coming, but he said, you take practice every day, every day. Don't worry.
Yeah.
All is coming.
No, the reason I asked that is because it's the title of Remsky's book, which is essentially a takedown of Patavi Joyce. Right. So I don't know if we're going to get into that at all, but you know, it's, These are tricky times to talk about revered teachers who have fallen, as has Swami Vishnu, by the way, the founder of Shivananda organization, who has recently been outed as being a sexual predator in some people's eyes. So, yeah.
I hadn't heard that till now.
Out there.
Yes, that's all out there. And I think it's all sobering for the yoga student and the yoga path. And it's about, we have personal responsibility to ourselves, not to abandon our, abandon agency. Ourselves to unknown. Yes. That we have agency in our life. So, what you were saying about the movement from the renunciants, the monks leading the intro of yoga, including, say, even Yogananda with self-realization and the householders taking over from, say, this Krishnamacharya lineage, is that the student and the teacher, the Western or the non-Indian students and teachers, they haven't quite caught up with that, because the student, many students have it all blended in their mind that yoga should still be free, that they should live with less, that earning money is somehow bad or harmful. There's very strong themes of that. And I do find myself explaining to people what householders are, what the grihastha are, and what our responsibilities are. I think rather than the Vedanta, the yoga for the householder is more aligned with the purushartha, with these four aims of life, of dharma, artha, kama, and veda. And in your wonderful interview with Desikachar, he talks about that his father said that comes at the end of life, that moksha, that liberation, that's at the end of life. And so here we are in the world, we're taking our yoga practice. They're benefiting our life day to day, I hope, because if they're not, go find the thing that is. And there is a time and a place for this moksha and to renounce. And that is at the end of the life. But in the meantime, do your duty and pay your Con Ed bill. And
well, right. Well, I mean, to go back to some of the themes that he developed in that interview you referenced, number one, it's only towards the end of life you actually have something to renounce. You know, you can't skip steps. This has commonly been referred to recently as spiritual bypassing, you know, when you want to kind of skip over the acquisition of a self. You know, you can't surrender yourself unless you have a self. And a self is something, in my view, that's actually self-constructed. You know, we make our own souls quite literally out of the choices that we've made over the course of our lives in the face of the things we didn't choose. So that was definitely an underlying theme of that conversation. And the way he summed it up was with a brilliant and beautiful analogy. And he was, you know, trying to gently but firmly cure me of the vestiges of my sort of ashram training, which, you know, was rejecting this idea that suffering or dukkha was at the sort of foundation of our motivation to study yoga. I thought, well, isn't our foundation ananda and bliss? And, you know, so I was in a bit of a conflict there. And when I started to suggest that, he said, well, no, actually, if you tell somebody who's suffering that their true essence is bliss, you're going to make them suffer more. And the analogy he used was, you know, if you encounter somebody that's suffering because he can't find his house, you know, he knows he has a house, he knows he's lived in it at some point, but now he can't find it and he's suffering. The thing you don't say to him is, oh yes, your house, there's a pot of gold buried under it. He will suffer more if that's how you approach that situation. And that just sort of stopped me in my tracks, and it really made me reassess a whole lot of assumptions that I was having about what our role was and what the role of suffering was in being motivated to study something like yoga, you know. And in a way, he was divesting me of the sort of Swami influence, if you will, by being very this worldly, very practical. And you know, so that's somewhat related to what we were saying about the householders versus the swamis and how they would approach something like, what's your motivation to even study yoga in the first place? So, yeah, that's the pot of gold story.
You were attracted to Shivananda, and you said, did you say, I'm going to go to Grass Valley and do a training? Or,
well, it wasn't Grass Valley because I was in New York. So I did my training in Val Marin, which is their main headquarters, Canada, in the Laurentian Mountains, north of Montreal. Yeah. It's the first time I ever left the country was to go do my training in summer of 1979. But I wouldn't say that I was attracted to Shivananda. I was attracted to yoga, and the yoga was available through Shivananda, right? It's not like I, you know, did a Google search of all of the places that were offering teacher training or in-depth study, because there was no Google.
There was no Google. And I remember opening the yellow pages, you would go to the end, and under why, there was like two yoga schools. Yeah.
Sure. Well, there was a time when I opened the New York yellow pages under yoga, and I pretty much knew everybody that was listed there personally. Right. That's how old I am. Number one, that I was using the yellow pages.
Yes.
And number two, that everyone listed there was like, you know, we all knew each other. So, you know, Shivananda was my access point to yoga. And as it turned out, I had some skills from my background in theater. I don't know if you know, I had a background in theater as well. But, you know, just in terms of production, they needed help because they were doing a big festival that summer of 79. And I stayed on to help build the stage and be the stage manager. And when you have skills that are valuable in an ashram, if you know how to get stuff done, you keep getting more and more responsibility. And that's just what happened to me up to the point where in 1981, I ended up in Kerala at the ashram there doing production and some of the teaching for a big teacher training program. There were like 140 people in that TTC in January of 81 in Kerala.
And you were 23 years old or something, and you're in
the... Yeah, I was young, you know.
Yeah, you were young.
And I became a Swami on that trip to India. And
what was that influence for you to take these vows and renounce the whole life that you had ahead of you?
Because at the tender age of 22, I had had enough of myself, mm-hmm, pretty much, you know. I figured I had had plenty of sex by then. I, you know, so renouncing that, no problem. I didn't have much of my own financial wherewithal, you know, to renouncing wealth. Like, I didn't have any, so fine. And I was willing to take the third vow, which is obedience to the guru, because basically Swami Vishnu was my teacher at that point. And, you know, it was more like becoming an employee than anything else. It's like, yeah, you listen to what the boss says. You know, I didn't have the sense that I was turning over my entire spiritual well-being to someone else. It was more like, yeah, I'm going to come on as staff. Tell me where to go. Tell me what to do. And they did. They sent me to Los Angeles. So I arrived there shortly after my birthday, when I turned 23, in March of 1981, to be the director of the center in West Hollywood, which was right on Sunset Strip.
Wow.
Interesting place to be in the early 80s, running a yoga center.
Right, when Sunset Strip was probably pretty close to Times Square at that time. It was...
Yeah, it was ground zero for a lot of
wild
stuff
urban
that was going on. Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I went to Los Angeles.
Not that I was doing any of it. I was, you know, I wasn't like going, you know, out and to the Comedy Store or the Rainbow or you know, Whiskey or Go-Go or anything like that.
Right.
But yeah. So
yes. When I went to Los Angeles, I moved there in 94, and Shivananda was in this charming little home over in Venice.
Yeah, they had already moved to the West Side by then. Sure.
Yeah, that was, but I spent a lot of time there. That was a nice spot.
Yeah. Yeah, actually, before that, they were in Westwood for a while. Actually, the migration of the Shivananda centers in L.A. is an interesting story, because the original center was on Larchmont.
Oh.
The center for yoga was the Shivananda center until Ganga White split off from Swami Vishnu and started his own thing going in that space, that beautiful old Masonic hall.
Right.
It was actually the second location Ganga was in, but it was the Shivananda center for a while. He split off. And then Shivananda Center moved to Hollywood, to McCadden Place. And from there it moved to Sunset in Selma, which is where I took it over. And it stayed there for a while after I left. And then it moved to Westwood and then to Venice. So it was sort of an itinerant center for that sort of 10-year period.
And then you were running or overseeing daily yoga classes and other related workshops and waking up early in the morning and leading the meditation and the chanting.
Yeah, that was my job. Yeah. Well, see, that's the thing. And this is the ironic thing about becoming the Swami, at least in that organization. But I think it's a principle in general that the minute you announce to the world that you're renouncing these things come back at you 100 times stronger than you could have imagined, right? And so when I became a Swami, the three vows, as I mentioned, are poverty, obedience, and celibacy, right? It's like becoming a priest in Catholicism, similar thing. And so what happened was I became full-time staff at that point, and I got sent to L.A., and far away from Swami Vishnu, who was off doing his peace missions and all of that stuff. And so, you know, in terms of, you know, obedience, everyone had to obey me. I was in charge, you know. I had renounced obedience. I renounced, you know, having a say in my own life, obedience to the guru. But all of a sudden, I was the teacher and everyone had to listen to me. I was handling more money than I'd ever seen in my life, because I was, you know, in charge of the finances of this. This is a small community. It wasn't just a center. There were people living there. They were paying rent and we were paying rent to the landlord, and we were buying groceries, and, you know, all of that I was in charge of more money than I'd ever seen. And as far as the celibacy is concerned, apparently there's nothing more attractive to a member of the opposite sex than someone that's taken a vow of celibacy.
Well, that is what I've heard from former...
Yes.
From former renunciates like yourself, and from witnessing, you know, women throw themselves at other renunciates. So,
well, you saw what happened to David when he took his vows at Jiva Mukti, didn't you? I mean,
David, life of Jiva Mukti.
Yeah,
the co-founder, he took vows at some point living in the groovy East Village, and he became like a rock star.
He came to me because he knew my background. He knew I had been a Swami, and he came to me one point and says, what did you do with all this? I said, well, I renounced my vows because I couldn't take it. You know, it's like,
you're 23 years old, Los Angeles.
Yeah, his vows lasted for less than a year, I think, which was similar to my, I lasted 9 months. So I don't know whose vows lasted longer or shorter, but it was close.
And then what became of your relationship to Shivananda at that time? Or how did you renounce? Did you talk with someone and were you like,
No, as I said, Swami Vishnu was off. No, he was off doing his own thing. And so I announced to the community one morning at meditation that I was renouncing my vows. I stayed on as director there for the better part of the next year because I was a good director, it turned out, and the center was thriving and doing well. But at a certain point, the cumulative transgressions became a little much for Swami Vishnu. And he ordered me to go back to the ranch, which at the time, it's in upstate New York, the ranch in the Catskills, right? At the time that was like being sent to Siberia because that was a collection of complete losers and miscreants and ex-cons. And, you know, they got up at 4 a.m. to turn the sprouts over in the bathtubs because they were running a sprout business. Right. It was basically like being sent to Siberia, and I refused. And as soon as you refuse the direct order of Swami Vishnu, then you're out of the organization. And that's when I left Shivananda. And that was in the fall of 1982. So, yeah.
And did you stay with those the practices that were meaningful for you? Did you... You renounced, and now you're out on your own, but you had some alignment with the yoga. Did you continue with those practices or some of them and continue into?
Well, I evolved them. And that was some of my transgression there was playing around with the sequence, you know, that I was teaching. So, you know, it was the backbone of my training and experience as both a practitioner and a teacher, the Shivananda way of teaching. But I kept teaching. I moved in with my girlfriend at the time, Linda Huey, who I'm still friends with. She's 11 years older than me and was an athlete and actually very much involved in athletic training and sports medicine. And that's where I got a lot of my experience in anatomy and physical rehab, because it was through Linda I got connected with the International Sports Medicine Institute in West LA at the corner of Motor and National, right? So you know LA, so you know exactly where that is. And you may also know that just down the road on Motor Avenue was Jane Fonda's first studio, where this whole group fitness thing would see we're not when we're talking about the era of yoga that you're talking about, we also have to talk about the evolution of the fitness industry in the West.
Absolutely.
Because when yoga joined forces with that, about, you know, the fitness had been an industry for about 10 years when it joined up with yoga in the early to mid 90s, because in the early to mid 80s when I was in LA was when fitness was becoming a thing. Jane Fonda with group fitness, the Olympics were coming in 84 to LA, the whole bodybuilding, weight training culture with the guys at Gold's Gym over on the West Side. Schwarzenegger and Franco Colombo, who was a chiropractor. I was working for a chiropractor. You know, so a lot of those guys showed up at the Sports Medicine Institute, as well as a lot of these athletes that were training for the Olympics in 84. Also, the other development, which is significant, was Nautilus. When you could safely work out with weights, as opposed to free weights, which is what the bodybuilders were using, right?
So you had a combination. Nautilus was a system, an innovative system of training, which we pretty much see in gyms today, even if it's not called the Nautilus system.
Right.
Weights are supported. you're sliding in the key, you're resetting.
Exactly.
You're using, so just what's going on in gyms today, this was totally innovative. We got some Nautilus equipment in my high school in like 1979. So it was very-
79, wow, that's early Nautilus, yeah.
Yes, and some of us girls were shown how to train with it. And this just shows you like, it's 79 is not that long ago, but to get to the weight room, you had to go through the boys' locker room. So it wasn't even considered that girls would ever have a reason to go into the weight room, but we were given permission and we were walked through when no boys were there and we could safely train on the Nautilus.
Sure.
So all of these kind of-
Without being spotted, without dropping weights and, you know-
Right,
without free weights are dangerous. Yeah.
Tendons. But so yes, the Nautilus made fitness, the possibility of training with weights open to so many more people and was definitely a boon to the gym industry. And I love this track that you're going on here with the fitness. Because I was always interested in fitness. I had, my father was a great athlete. He played club rugby my whole life until his 50s. He lettered in track at Michigan State. He went off to school on a scholarship. So I was always interested in fitness and I ran through high school. I was a dancer. I trained in dance from a young age. And when I lived in New York City, you know, in the early 80s, I was out running. I was going to yoga class. I was going to Joy of Movement. I was going to Alvin Ailey. I was taking some fitness training classes. People said to me, what are you doing? Where are you going? Like, it's hard for people today to imagine. There was, fitness was so niche. Fitness, just the idea that someone would run because it gives them pleasure or that they would train because they wanted to feel or look a certain way, and have a certain strength. Of course, fitness in LA, I say now the whole world is like Los Angeles, but Los Angeles was very uniquely Los Angeles in the 60s, 70s, 80s, and 90s. And obviously appearance at a premium there. So Hollywood people were very open to fitness, yoga, and all the rest. So here you are at the crossroads.
But there was a fitness, sort of natural fitness culture that existed in LA from the 50s and 60s. Guys like Gypsy Boots and the Nature Boys and all that. I got to meet Gypsy, by the way. He used to hang out at the yoga center.
That's great.
You know, and he was quite a trip. But you know, so there was that. But also the running craze that had been in full gear by then. And the other thing we should mention, Title IX, right? Because when women, girls in school started getting equal access to sports budgets, you know, and training facilities and all of that, you can't possibly underestimate the influence of that as well. You know, Linda, who I mentioned, Linda Huey, she was a national class sprinter pre-Title IX, right? In the late 60s, she had to train with the men's track team.
Right.
Now, she was at San Jose State, so the men's track team were the fastest men on the planet.
Right.
She trained with the Speed City gang, the guys in Mexico City who were doing that, right? So, you know, that it didn't hurt her as an athlete to have these guys to train with, but that was pre-Title IX. You know, you were talking about late 70s, right? And Nautilus starts showing up in for girls in schools, that's Title IX at work right there.
Well, we had no, when I started track, I had to train with the boys team. And I thought the coach was a creep and he totally ignored us. I went to the principal and I said, we want a coach. And my school got us the greatest coach. He was the head of the Westchester Roadrunners Club. He was a marathon runner. He was a coach. He treated us as athletes. He didn't treat us as girls. He treated us as athletes. And I was part of a county, you know, acclaimed 2 mile relay team. He, knew I was a half miler. Like he really trained us in distance and cross country. But yes, absolutely. Those were very different times. There's a great documentary on the founder of the New York Marathon. And you know, those first Fred Lebo marathon runners. It was all about, yeah.
Sure. Yeah. Fred Lebo. Yeah. So, yeah. We knew Fred a little bit. Yeah. Well, also, let's not leave out all the work that Beryl was doing at the time with the Roadrunners Club, right? She was teaching Ashtanga, calling it the hard and the soft, but one of the first people to really merge yoga and fitness, and this was happening in New York, of course, was Beryl Bender. And she was a student of Batabi Joyce's. And this is before Jiva Mukti, it's before Sharon and David went, and Eddie and Uma went to Mysore to learn Ashtanga, right? So a lot of this was in the mix in New York and in the West Coast at the time, for sure.
So Beryl Bender was teaching Ashtanga yoga with a few variations through the New York Roadrunners Club, where some of the world's greatest runners and aspiring runners were participating. Yes,
and that's let's not forget that a lot of the students who were attracted to Ashtanga early on were ex-runners, runners who had kind of abused their bodies with running, and they wanted to do something that was athletic, that was challenging, but it was healthier for them. So that was a lot of the fuel that went into that fire that really took off with the Ashtanga influence and the fitness world at the time. So, yeah.
I think another influence for Ashtanga coming out of the East Village, and Jiva Mukti coming out of the East Village, and those of us that were at Jiva Mukti, I first met Sharon and David as artists. We were artists.
Sure. Yes.
At Avenue B. You know, they lived and operated off of Avenue B. And is that artists, we had so many artists or culture-minded people or people kind of living on the edge of the city in the East Village, looking at expression and being very open-minded, who were attracted to yoga. And so yoga was a tool to expand the mind. There was many other mind expansion tools over there on the periphery that I did not participate in, like drugs, but I did see yoga for expanding my mind, my ability to express as a dancer, performer, artist, actress, and for, you know, physically for my body as well. So we did see really sharply focused people willing to kind of travel far, put their bodies through a lot, and sort of take risks or open their mind to things that might have seemed overly esoteric or something. They were in the search for some kind of peak experience.
Sure. Well, the early days of Jiva, and it did the ethos did continue when it got more systematized, but it was yoga as performance art.
You know? Absolutely.
And it was like the cheapest theater ticket in town, and it was audience participation. That was the way I looked at it. And I actually had that conversation once with Sharon and David. I said, this is great. This is like, I said exactly what I just said. This is like the cheapest theater ticket in town. It's audience participation, and you're getting healthy and spiritual at the same time. This is yoga as performance art. And they looked at me like, huh? And it's like, yes, of course. Can't you see what you're doing here?
Of course.
This is every night there's a new performance, and people are just, you know, going crazy for it. You couldn't even get a mat in that room.
No, you couldn't. And what about the talent shows, the holiday talent shows? I mean, that was like some of the best performance ever.
Yeah, absolutely.
So many creative people there.
So how did, I have a question for you. At what point did, I'm sorry, we have a time lag here. We're talking over each other. I apologize. But I have a question for you before you ask me my next question. That's okay. When did Dana get involved in all this? Were you first? Did you bring her into all of this, or was it the other way around?
I was first. Mm-hmm. I started yoga, you know, accidentally in college when I was about 19 years old. And from everything that I was learning from these different classes and courses, created my own daily practice. I was like, these things are important, doing this breathing, doing this movement, doing these sun salutations, the kind of, you know, theater that I did. I moved into the experimental theater wing, and you always did like group warm-ups, and the whole ensemble of theater actors would connect. I was like, you guys, we have to do our warm-up all together. And I kind of became known for leading sun salutations and leading yoga classes and stuff. So I got involved with that. I would say my sister Dana of Laughing Lotus, She got involved with yoga, I think, at 30. She'd been, you know, in Wall Street. She founded a really exciting restaurant that also had a performance art aspect, Trixie's. Uh-huh. And then I think she was looking for, you know, balance and rest and another focus for her very social, you know, outgoing life of being this restaurateur, this hostess with the mostess. And so I'd say maybe 10 years later or something, she got involved.
Interesting.
She became interested and, you know, she's a real dynamo. So she...
Yeah. I just remember her rolling into Jiva on those roller skates,
deep
right?
I remember when the sign went up next to the stairs that said no roller skates in the school, which... Chances are that was only
that
for
was
her.
Totally about Trixie. That was totally about Trixie. She was the only one. Who else would be there with roller skates? And I'm so happy you mentioned ETW, Experimental Theater Wing at NYU. Are you aware of the Richard Schechner connection to Krishnamacharya?
No.
Yeah.
Tell all.
There was an article.
Richard Schechner. I just want to keep our people up to to speed, if we even can do that.
Yeah.
Richard Schechner is a very influential, what I'll call experimental theater, really pushing the form of theater and expression, and through the 50s, 60s, 70s, and then was involved with NYU, I think through the Experimental Theater Wing, as well as the Gallatin Division. And so he has
co-founder of the Worcester Group, very influential, right? The brief version of this, and there was a whole article in Namarupa magazine that I worked with Eddie to produce with Richard.
Oh, I have to find it.
From his journals, maybe you can post a link to it on this, but because he kept journals, right? So a friend, Daniel Dale, a friend of mine who studied with us at the Breathing Project, was teaching at a gym somewhere, a yoga class. And as he was finishing up, this elderly man came in the corner of the room, started doing his own practice. Immediately, Daniel recognizes the way he's doing yoga, the way he's moving with his breath and so on, right? And he goes up to him and, you know, excuses him for interrupting, but it's like, would you mind telling me where you learned that? And the gentleman says, oh, years ago in the 70s, I traveled to India and I learned this from a man, you've probably never heard of him. His name's Krishnamacharya. And, you know, as soon as Daniel picks his jaw off the floor, he's like, you have to tell me more. Turns out the guy was Richard Schechner. And so that ended up with Schechner coming into the Breathing Project with his journals that he had kept, with photos and drawings and stick figures and everything from the 70s, and presenting to a group of my students who were there. And that turned into sitting down with Eddie at his place about a year or so later. And there's a whole article that goes over this influence that he brought from Krishnamacharya into his work with actors in terms of breathing and postures and all of that. And he, from that brief time he spent with Krishnamacharya, I don't know how many thousands upon thousands of people have been influenced because of who Richard was, right? Including you, apparently.
Right.
So there you have it.
Amazing. Yeah. I love that. We definitely, it's interesting. It's almost as if through the East Coast, it's coming through more of an artist lens, this development of yoga and expression, and like you're saying, performance art. And I think there was a lot of awareness being in the East Village where so much of this yoga developed of what had come before, that we're like following the, you know, we're walking down the same sidewalks as, you know, Ferlinghetti or Ginsberg or, and so there was a rich cultural history, art, culture, beat, punk history. And then with the yoga. And then meanwhile, I'm loving hearing this fitness, the birth of fitness yoga in California. So I wanted to get back to that.
Sure, absolutely. And by the way, before I forget, I'll send you the info. I don't know if you know Natalia Melman Petrozella. She's at the New School. She's a scholar who researches exactly this. And she's also a teacher.
Oxford?
And I think you would enjoy speaking with her. No, she's at the New School.
Is she at Oxford? Oh, she's at the New School. Okay, great.
Yeah. No,
yeah,
and because she interviewed me and looked at my archives, because I saved all the stuff from those years. And she was like, it was like a treasure trove for her. And she'd be a great person to talk to in this same thread. But back to the fitness and back to LA. So what was the next question there?
So you were saying Jane Fonda's over there. The Olympics are coming to town. We have this, you know, kind of Gold's Gym, pumping iron on Venice Beach. And this is a very uniquely LA thing because there's so much focus on perception of appearance and wanting to be fit and on your game for that kind of LA industry. And then you're saying there was this moment where these fitness people and the yoga people converged, or this movement, which absolutely influences where we are with the yoga today and coming out of the influence of LA on the yoga world.
Yeah, I mean, that's what sent it into hyperdrive as far as the yoga industry is concerned. We didn't start using the word industry with the word yoga until the, I'd say, mid-90s. And so a lot of it had to do with Ashtanga Vinyasa style of practicing. And, you know, being at ground zero on the East Coast with that, you and I both know where that came from, right? There was that trip that Sharon and David and Eddie Stern and Uma, my Uma, not little Uma, big Uma, Uma McNeil, took in 91 into 92, you know, to Mysore to work with Patabi Joyce for the first time. And that of course ended up with them changing their teaching style. But in fairness, Sharon and David, they were already linking things together in choreographic ways prior to meeting Patabi Joyce, right? They already had that thing going on because they were doing that on, you know, Avenue B before they moved to Second Avenue.
Yes, I think there was.
And Go ahead.
Sharon had a dance background and she had a very good creative skill for blending asanas in a dance-like flow and creating some very engaging and inspiring sequences, which we
and
see
she was already teaching at fitness places. She's already teaching at fitness places, right?
Right.
Joy of movement.
Many people might not know Sharon.
And,
Sharon was a top aerobics teacher, and she was kind of a punk poetess aerobics teacher. And so she was already there inspiring people. And then I think she did some trainings at Shivananda, and now she's in a wonderful position to say, hey, can I also teach yoga here on this schedule? So she brought a lot of people into yoga through those fitness relationships.
Yeah. And it just got a huge shot of adrenaline with the Ashtanga Vinyasa influence, because here you have a tradition, you're linked to Krishnamacharya through Patabi Joyce. There's a whole, you know, there's a whole Hindu aesthetic that they sort of attach to all of this. And once the folks that were running the gyms and the group fitness places got a hint of this way of practicing, they just wanted more of it, and they wanted it on their schedule. And there was that time, and we're talking, you know, early to mid 90s here, where this is all happening, when, strange as it seems now, you know, looking back, the demand for yoga teachers far outstripped the supply.
Oh, absolutely. You know?
And it was inevitable that somebody would jump into that with a business model, and that was Beth Shaw. And she came out of the fitness industry, had some training in yoga, and she was like, look, you've already got people on your payroll who know how to lead group fitness. They're called aerobics teachers. Give them to me for a weekend. I'll train them up on how to teach a yoga class. On Monday after that weekend, you can have yoga on your schedule. And that's Yoga Fit. That's how that was born. And so it was brilliant. I'm not in any way criticizing Beth for doing that, because there was a supply and demand issue going on. But what that created was a reaction with folks like me that have been doing this, like, you know, all their adult lives. It's like, hang on. We're not quite sure how many hours it takes to create a yoga teacher, but we're pretty sure a weekend isn't enough. And so we started sitting down and having these discussions. So we started having these discussions. These discussions turned into the ad hoc committee that came up with the standards of 200 and 500 hours. And that turned into the Yoga Alliance. The ironic thing, looking at that history of the Alliance and the fact that a bunch of us looked at what Beth was doing, saying that's not enough. Now, today, there's, you know, lifers like me who are looking at what the Alliance is doing and saying, hey, that's not enough, right? And so there's always going to be that reaction to whatever the status quo is. And that's in the nature of yoga. Yoga, the origin of yoga is a reaction to the status quo. It's the shramanas going off into the woods, into the forest, saying, you know, screw you to the Vedic society. You know, we're going to go figure some shit out, and we don't want to, you know, be sitting around sacrificing to the gods all day long, right? And so it's always renewing itself. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And there's always this renewal that it has to go through. And it's always about reacting to the status quo. When certain aspects of yoga become part of the status quo, you can bet that some folks are going to say, screw you, and they're going to go off and do their own thing. And that's as it should be. That's not a problem.
History has room for that. So also in LA, we have a real force of nature who has left us too soon, Mati Ezrati.
Mati, yeah.
And she
Mati and Chuck and Al Finger. Don't forget Al Finger was part of that.
Right, and Al Finger starting Yoga Works. And here Mati had an extraordinary ability to really, I would say, tap yoga teaching talent and to really give a platform to someone like a Brian Kest or a Sean Korn, a Rod Stryker, like so many. When I moved to Los Angeles in 94, we didn't have any like superstar, you know, yoga teachers in New York. And I went to LA and teachers were stars. Farron Baptiste had been teaching in LA and he had gotten a job with the Philadelphia Eagles American football team. And he had just left LA. This is not an exaggeration. I met women like who would begin to cry, beautiful young actresses. They'd be like, you're a yoga teacher. You just moved here. I want to do yoga. My yoga teacher, Farron Baptiste, just left. Like, to teach Baptiste yoga. I was like, I don't even know what Baptiste yoga is. But I was really introduced that there were these, you know, incredibly charismatic, physically, you know, splendid men who had throngs of fans, and they and we didn't have this kind of yoga star teacher yet. And then what you had in LA was, say, these Hollywood producers' wives, in addition to, you know, actresses and everyone else, going to these teachers' classes and saying, my husband is starting a VHS wing of Columbia. Why don't you come do yoga tapes and everything like that? So there was
you're talking about Tara Guber, aren't you? Because
and Brian Kett.
They produced Well, see, first of all, Mati didn't have to recruit Rod. Rod came with Al Finger.
Oh, that's right.
Rod Stryker was a student of Alan Finger's back then. And he, along with a bunch of other super pretty people, appeared in Yoga Moves, which was Alan Finger's VHS contribution to the yoga instructional world. But it was like, have you seen it?
No.
Oh my God.
I almost want to end this interview now. Like, Yoga Moves. Oh my God.
Oh my God. Yeah. If Al could find every copy of that and burn it, I'm sure he would. Yeah. Oh my God. It is so overproduced. It's almost like an 80s parody of a yoga video. And you get to see Rod almost naked, wearing just a tiny little, you know, like dance belt. And the female he's with is naked in one of these sequences. It is just, it's fantastic. I love watching it.
And the fact that Rod Steiger's name does sound like a porn star's name, it just makes this all the more enticing.
Well, it's better than Nimrod Gross.
Yes. So, okay, so we have Alan Finger. So we have Yoga Works. And we have Mati, and we have all these beautiful people pouring into Yoga Works. And people with a great need to adore and worship their teachers. And we see this incredible yoga celebrity rise up. And then I think Yoga Journal, it's very interesting, you know, when there's one industry magazine, if you're in that magazine, you're kind of a leader, perceived as a leader. And I always say anyone that took an ad in Yoga Journal in the 80s, they all kind of hit big careers, you know, or the 90s. Richard Freeman sold his own video DVD in there. David Swensen did. Sharon and David put their yoga calendars in there. That had a lot of sway for the reader when you have a full page ad.
Well, don't forget the other Rod in the conversation, because he became the poster boy for Yoga Journal's own products. Okay.
Right. Rodney Yee.
Exactly. I was waiting for you.
Yes. I was like, Rod, Rodney Yee.
Rodney. Yes, so exactly.
So then Yoga Journal got into the calendar business and started featuring 12 lucky winners a year. And then they got into the producing business and really.
Yeah, but you see, but here's the thing about Yoga Journal. If you look at the era immediately preceding the one you're talking about, they didn't have yoga on the cover ever. There were no photos of people doing asanas on the cover. They had every other new age subject or, you know, whatever. They did not have yoga on the cover. There was an incredible stretch of, I don't know how many issues. I counted once, and I could tell you if I looked in my records. But that changed in the era we're talking about when you know, because there was the idea of a fitness celebrity at that point as well, you know. Jane Fonda, of course, being at the absolute top of the pyramid, but she spawned a whole bunch of other people, you know, the Kathy Smiths and you had Richard Simmons was a fitness celebrity, and, you know, all of these people, even our good friend Molly, right? Molly Fox came out of that era. Yeah. And so the fact that you could have someone that was really good looking, that was exemplifying some aspirational, feeling that people would have about where they wanted to be with themselves, with their bodies. Yoga just fits so beautifully into that. And then you had that era where Yoga Journal finally started putting people doing yoga on their cover again. But it wasn't always that way for Yoga Journal.
It could just be because the paper quality couldn't have reproduced color. The original Yoga Journal was a little more newsprinty.
Well, it was. They produced it, you know, Judith and Rama Jyoti Vernon and all their friends produced it, like, I think it was in Rama's kitchen at first, or Judith's kitchen. I forget whose kitchen it was. But no, we're talking about when it was a glossy four-color, you know, publication, there was a time when they didn't have yoga on the cover. Mm. It was really remarkable how long they went before they started doing that. Yeah.
So how did you find your way back to New York and eventually to meet Desikachar?
Are you a yoga teacher or wellness coach dreaming of earning a professional income doing what you love? Yoga Success with Kiki is a coaching and entrepreneurial program for you. Learn a system with the inner and outer supports that changes lives. Learn more and work with Kiki at yogasuccesswithkiki.com. You can learn to earn your yoga and wellness living.
And what were you doing in New York? You were running your own school.
I had a place in the East Village. It was called Yogatone. At the Rap Arts Center. Remember the Rap Arts Center?
Of course I know the Rap Arts Center. So you were in a community arts center that was an old...
And guess who was running his illegal t-shirt business on the ground floor of the Rap Arts Center?
Eddie Stern?
Exactly. I met Eddie before he was a yoga teacher. He was doing bootleg t-shirts.
Did he have a mohawk or a long red braid down his back?
No. He still had the very long red hair at that point. Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
Yes. Well, through my theater, you know, my various downtown theater companies and rehearsals, you know, I was involved over in Rap Arts for different rehearsals and things like that.
Sure. You must have known Howard Fireheart. Remember Howard Fireheart? Remember Crazy Howard Fireheart? He was in there, and
I feel like
that was a whole microclimate of East Village down and out artists that were associated with the Rap Art Center, and we were up on the third floor with Yogatone at the time, and it was a pretty nice space, and it was somewhat affordable rent. But I came back to New York when the Olympics were over. So like in the winter of 84 is when I came back. And at the time, my relationship with Linda was sort of ending, and, you know, we couldn't manage the bi-coastal thing. But I came back to take over the apartment that I had on East 7th Street, because the subtenant there was leaving, and I wanted to keep the lease because it was a very cheap rent. And so...
Was it under $200?
Yeah. Sure.
Yeah. My rent was $235 when I got it in 1983, I guess, in the East Village. So imagine that we could earn like $35, $40 a yoga class as a teacher at that time, and our rent was only $200. They were very different days. It gave us a lot of time to practice yoga, to study yoga, to travel, and to grow and learn. Sure. And
yeah, so let's not underestimate the power of the rent control laws in New York City funding
absolutely.
The education of yoga teachers.
Absolutely.
My rent was $160 when I moved in 1977.
Amazing. You
know, so anyway, I came back, and interesting side note, in 1985 is when I had my first exposure to Ashtanga yoga, way before most of the other folks. And it was a student of David Williams.
With Robert Moses?
No, Rob, you see, Robert, Swami Shankarananda, as I knew him, he learned from Norman Allen, right?
Right.
And so he had his own Hawaii connection. But David Williams was on Maui. And he had a bunch of students going way back into the late 70s. And one of them, Shelley Zegri, was in New York. And she came, I paid her to come to my apartment on 7th Street every morning for a month to teach me Ashtanga primary. And that was in 1985.
Amazing.
So yeah, and that was my own little exposure to it at that point. But that was before I met Desikachar. I met him in 1988. So I was exposed to Krishnamacharya's teachings and some of the Bandha and breath stuff, not through Desikachar, but through the Ashtanga methodology, 3 years, fully 3 years before I met Desikachar in 88.
And I did want to say Norman Allen just recently passed this week.
I didn't know that. Oh, no. Oh, my.
Yes.
That's the first I've heard.
Certainly wow. Very influential, really. Introducing in a larger way, or from something that we knew as like West Coast Maui yoga or West Coast yoga or Big Island yoga. That's how I first heard about Ashtanga. Norman Allen was one of the first students, early students from North America up at Tavi Joyce, and then responsible for continuing to practice in.
Big props to Norman. I didn't know he passed.
Life,
Listen, I'll never forget the sight, okay, of Norman. He was in New York at the time at the Schwitz on 10th Street, right? The famous Russian and Turkish baths.
Russian baths, hot room, in the banya.
Okay. Norman and Tridam Das, who was a former Hare Krishna, who was a student of Norman's, who learned Ashtanga from him, and Derek Ireland, all of them in the hot room at the Schwitz, doing friggin' Ashtanga primary in 200 degree heat.
With handstands, because I met Tridam there doing Ashtanga before I'd ever seen Ashtanga in the Schwitz.
Exactly.
And I was like, what is that man doing?
It's a shame you weren't there on the day I was there with Derek, because I brought Derek there, because Derek was an old friend of mine. I arranged for Derek and Radha, whose real name is Leslie as well. They were students at the Shivananda Center in West Hollywood when I was the director. They were driving all the way up from like San Diego, from like Lemon Grove or someplace in San Diego, several times a week to do yoga.
Wow.
In West LA. Now, you know, if only they'd known at the time that Tim Miller was right in their backyard in Encinitas, right? But they were coming all the way, but they had, no one had heard of Ashtanga then. They were coming to do Shivananda yoga with us. And I arranged for them to do teacher's training in the Bahamas with Shankarananda, with Robert Moses, who was the director at the time. They didn't have any money. They could barely afford to travel there, but they had this like really impressive super boombox portable sound system. And I said, look, let them trade the sound system and some karma yoga for their teacher training. And Robert said yes. And so that's how they ended up in Nassau and Paradise Island. And they eventually became the directors when Shankarananda left to go to the ranch. But it was there that Robert showed them Ashtanga that he had learned from Norman Allen. I thought Derek was seeing it for the first time in the Schwitz when I was there with him. But he had already been shown it on the tennis court in Paradise Island by Robert, who learned it from Norman.
And so, I want to add about Derek Ireland. Derek Ireland certainly passed away too young, but Derek Ireland is very, and Radha are very important in sort of the dissemination or dissemination of Ashtanga yoga, because they eventually opened a retreat center called the Practice Place on Crete. Most Europeans at that time and Brits who were first introduced to Ashtanga yoga were introduced by Derek Ireland, a former rugby player, looked like a god from, 200 yards away. And if you got close to
central casting Greek god. Radha Derek was the most beautiful human being.
Yeah. Radha, the flower child with her hair down to her hips, and they were a beautiful.
I'm straight up, cisgendered hetero, but if I were to be gay, I would totally be gay with Derek Ireland. I got to tell you.
Irresistible. And so even someone like Jocelyn Stern, she first learned Ashtanga yoga there in Crete at the practice plan of Derek and Radha. Hamish Hendry, longtime Ashtanga yogi running London Shala, he was there. So many Europeans, many Australians first learned there. And I think Derek was New Zealander.
He was a Brit.
Lot of people from, he was a Brit. So that was very influential. They were very influential.
Sure. And what a lot of people don't know about Derek is he did all of that. He did all of that with a completely blown out ACL on one leg. He never got it repaired. And because he got that was a rugby injury. And he never got the ACL repaired, but he managed to keep that knee functional. And he did all of the Ashtanga he did with a blown out knee, which I thought was pretty remarkable. He was also the most accident prone person I'd ever met in my life. He was always having one injury or another.
I have heard these stories.
Yeah. There's a time he nearly immolated himself with a camp stove in Greece. I mean, the man literally set himself on fire. You know, and so, you know, having survived all of his accidents, all of his injuries, for one of his own testicles to take him out, it made no sense to me that something like that would do him in, because he had certainly had so many opportunities to kill himself with all the accidents he'd been involved in over the years. Anyway, he was a sweet, sweet man. I love Derek dearly. And yes, he did leave us way too soon.
There's a wonderful, it's a motley cast of characters, totally memorable and, you know, have made extraordinary impressions. So you were introduced to Ashtanga 5 and these little morning sessions, and now you come to meet Desikachar. How did that come about? Because he was not, that was not an easy discovery at that time. That was, you were quite pioneering, certainly. Desikachar, that was a more quiet.
Well, certainly there were people that pioneered with Desikachar way before me. I'm still very much a junior member of that community, considering how old some of these people are now, like Larry Payne. See, I first heard about Desikachar from Larry Payne, and I met him when I was the director of the Shivananda Center in LA, and he had just gotten back from this trip to India where he had visited all of these teachers. And he was most impressed with the one that I hadn't heard of, Desikachar. And he told me what most impressed him was that it was all in the breath. And he didn't really say much more about it than that, but it stuck in my mind. It's like, it's all in the breath. And that began influencing how I was teaching and looking at the students I was teaching at the time at the Shivananda Center. And I'm sure I didn't remember the name Desikachar beyond that conversation. I just remember there was this guy that Larry was impressed by who said it's all in the breath. And so you'd have to fast forward to like 1987 to when I read an article in Yoga Journal that had been written by David Frawley based on some time he spent in Maui teaching, where he met Gary Kraftsow, who at the time was based in Maui. And so this article that David wrote about Gary really resonated with me, because the things I heard Gary saying were so almost identical to some of the things that I had come to say and understand in just my own independent exploration of working with the breath and working with teaching yoga. And so I was determined to meet Gary. Now he was in Maui, I was in New York. I couldn't just pick up and go there and study with him. But when I called to make contact with Gary, actually Mirka, his wife at the time, called me back and we had a conversation. And she told me that Gary was gonna be presenting at this Unity in Yoga conference that was happening later that year in 87. And so that's what motivated me to sign up for my first Unity in Yoga conference, was mainly to meet Gary. And I went, I met him, I asked a lot of annoying questions. And he said that his teacher, Desikachar, who I then remembered was the guy that Gary told me about, you know, from reading about him in the article, it's like, oh yes, that was the guy with all in the breath. No wonder there's a resonance there. So he told me Desikachar was doing a seminar in the summer of 1988 at Colgate University.
And so
that's how I heard about how to meet Desikachar. And it's also how I got involved in Unity in Yoga. I eventually became the vice president of Unity in Yoga and worked to produce conferences with them. including the big one in 93, which is the 100th anniversary of Yoga in America, where, of course, I helped to produce that dance performance that Karen Carlton, Maud Carlson choreographed. This dance performance that was sort of in the finale evening event of that that conference we produced at Tamamint Lodge in the Poconos. So there was a lot of things that came together there in the whole unity and yoga thing, and you know, the ad hoc committee and the Yoga Alliance, which actually is Unity and Yoga. Unity and Yoga is the Yoga Alliance. They changed their name. It's the same organization.
Yeah, that's so
interesting.
So
by the summer of
I didn't realize that until
I met Desikachar.
Boning up on sitting down with you.
Oh, right.
And what was that teaching format when you met Desikachar? Was everyone sitting on the floor? Were they in chairs?
At the seminar?
Did he? Oh. Yeah.
Well, it was a combination of breakout sessions with some of his senior teachers who would lead practice in the morning, and then we'd all come together as one group in the afternoon for a couple of sessions. And it was wherever people were comfortable. It was a combination of us sitting on the floor, people sitting in chairs. It was, you know, it wasn't like an amphitheater where there were, you know, seats attached to the floor. There was just a big open room, and we just sat as we were comfortable. And me being who I am, I kind of ended up, you know, running the microphone system. That's my background in theater arts again, showing up and, you know, all of that. But it was really remarkable. And in retrospect, such a rare opportunity, because he was traveling quite a bit. He was teaching in Colgate in the summers, and then he'd go to California and teach in California somewhere. And there were a few things he did in Europe. And I just showed up wherever he was for that period of time from 88 until, well, you know, pretty much the last time I saw him in 2009. You know, I formally requested to be his student in our first one-on-one meeting. It was in Colgate in 89, not the first year I met him, but the second year. And so we always had sort of a formal kind of relationship, not as sort of close and friendly and part of the family as some of his senior students became. It was always a little bit of this formality and distance that was what worked for me. And he was very aware of my background with Shivananda and my Swami history and all of that. And so he knew that I understood something about the tradition from that perspective. And that's where I was coming from. But it was, every time I came together with him, whether it was in group or privately, it was always very powerful for me. And I always needed time to go off and digest and really assimilate what I had learned, you know. And so I couldn't have, even if I had been able to at that point in my life, because I had a center, I had a family, you know, I couldn't just pick up and move to India for 6 months at a time like some of these other people. And that wouldn't have worked for me anyway, because I needed time to just withdraw and assimilate what was going on. And that was always my process of being, you know, having very, very intense connection and then separation and alternating between that and just needing that time on my own to absorb and digest what was happening.
So at what point did you, or at least I think you did this at some point, say, you know, this is yoga therapy. This isn't just yoga teaching. And there is this kind of niche group of yoga therapists and this journal. What was it that you were doing or that you were learning that there was some kind of reframing for you? If there was.
That was a natural thing. What I would say is that an important part of the story for me personally is that how I was actually earning my living was not primarily through yoga. It was through body work. It was through my hands-on practice. You know, as you know, back in the day, you know, whenever anyone got injured in class, they'd usually get my phone number from someone, right? and so I had acquired these skills gradually over the years from my time spent at the Sports Medicine Institute. When I came back to New York, I was working for an osteopath who was very well known for working in the dance and the arts community, a guy named Richard Bachrach. I worked for him for a while. And eventually I started my own private practice of body work. And for me, the yoga and the body work were always the same thing. It was always about finding space in people's bodies. It was always about helping them to breathe better. And so whether the tools I was using were my hands or my words, it was always the same thing for me. So the idea that yoga could be applied therapeutically was never even a question for me. It was just like, that's what it was. And the fact that there were people calling themselves yoga therapists and that there was something called the International Association of Yoga Therapists, and the people who started that were students of Desikachar's, because Larry Payne and Richard Miller were the founders of IAYT. And so there was this very strong IAYT. Ethos. Yeah, through this yoga therapy movement that came directly from Desikachar. So yeah, I saw myself as being part of that until I didn't, until I kind of rejected the idea of yoga therapist as a title for myself. And there's a variety of reasons for that. I wrote an article for the journal, for the IAYT journal, that I'm not a yoga therapist anymore is the name of the title. And I sort of explained my reasons at that point. But it wasn't that I saw myself as being or doing anything different. It's just that that title and the word therapist became problematic for me because of regulatory issues and various other things that were important to me. So.
And in your time, so did you ever get to India and see how Desikachar was teaching there?
Yeah, in 92, that's where that interview that you referenced happened, was in Madras in 92. And I went back again in 96, but that was again in a production capacity more than anything to help produce a symposium on alternative healing systems that was being hosted at the KYM by Desikachar. And I was doing that in conjunction with the Aperture Foundation. A good friend of mine, one of my dearest friends, Michael Hoffman, was the executive director of the Aperture Foundation, which is a fine art photography publisher. But Michael was very interested in spirituality and had a very wonderful connection with Desikachar when I introduced them. And the result of that was the book Health, Healing, and Beyond, Yoga and the Living Tradition of Krishnamacharya, which I sort of helped to usher into existence in various ways. And so as a follow-up to that, we were there in 96 to produce this event, which wasn't open to the public. It was just all these people presenting to each other, you know, Ayurveda, yoga therapy, traditional Chinese medicine, Tibetan medicine. Tenzin Chodak was there. He was the Dalai Lama's personal physician. The man spent 30 years in a Chinese prison. Anthroposophical medicine was represented. Yanni Chapman was there representing the work she was doing with Lerner in Commonweal, you know, using yoga for cancer therapy. And a lot of that also became part of the Ornish protocol because she and Nishala Devi are the ones that developed the whole yoga meditation protocol for Dean Ornish. So there was a lot of that present at this symposium. And there was supposed to be a book that came out of it that never happened. Michael passed away, sadly, again, too young in 2001. So, but I do have some footage of the event, which I think I'm the only person that has it anymore because everyone at Aperture seems to have forgotten about it. But it was quite a remarkable, Claude Maréchal was there. Desikachar is probably most senior European student, and he was part of the presentation as well. It was a really extraordinary visit. But again, I got to be the guy behind the microphones and the cameras, although I got to present my work as well at one point. So I have some interesting video archives, I gotta tell you.
I know. Where are we gonna get to, when are we gonna get to see those?
Just ask. I mean, I also, you know what I have? I have a grainy old a video of the fundraiser that we did at Jiva Mukti at Second Avenue for the Unity and Yoga conference. And there's footage of David teaching. There's footage of Yas Houston teaching Sanskrit. I think there's a little of Kevin Gardner in there. My friend Ciro Baptista was doing a musical thing. He's a Brazilian percussionist. But it's just a real time capsule of what it was like to be in Jiva Mukti from early morning until late evening during this fundraiser that we did. We worked pretty closely on that conference.
I think you were very early in creating online teaching communities and sharing teaching and teaching forums through, and it doesn't surprise me now hearing of your production background, but through video and through blogging and through messaging, message boarding and everything like that. And certainly everyone is just jumping on Zoom now to teach, but you've been on there, I don't even know how long, 5-6 years or more in terms of video.
11 years. Yeah.
Well done.
Well, thank you. But you see, that wasn't Zoom so much. That was us sticking cameras in the room when I was teaching my courses and just putting those up as courses you could do asynchronously online. And that was 11 years ago.
Yeah, people are just learning how to do that now, but it's something that you you saw as valuable. And you were able to teach people all over the world or invite people into the classroom from all over the world. If anything you want to say about that, then I also wanted to ask you about the yoga anatomy.
Sure. Well, what we learned early on from putting the courses online back in 2009 was that there were advantages. You know, I mean, the gold standard is, and always has been for yoga, spending face-to-face time with the person you're learning from, in real time, breathing the same air, being able to interact the way that interaction has happened for thousands of years. But what if that's not available, either financially or time-wise or commitment-wise or whatever, you know? So the advantage primarily is accessibility. But more than that, there's the ability to pause, to rewind, to fast forward, to consume this information in a way and at a pace that works for you as an individual. We also provided written transcripts of every word that came out of my mouth when I was teaching. Some people actually absorb the material better if they're reading the words. We built interactivity into it in terms of people being able to ask questions and have them answered and all of that. But, you know, start whenever you want to start, finish whenever you want to finish. You have lifetime access to the material. So we really leveraged all the advantages that online learning allowed for. Now, with this latest wave of Zoom, because of the pandemic, I think there's more advantages that are becoming apparent. Remember how the hot topic right up to the pandemic was how we need to do something about inappropriate touch in teaching environments? Well, you can't do that anymore because you can't touch people because you're not in the same room as them. So that conversation is off the table. But more than that, I think what I've been learning about the online experience And if it's live streamed, you know, so we call it live now. This is live. We're live right now. People are not going to be seeing this live in real time, but we're live in real time, but we're just not live in person. So we have to add qualifiers to the word live these days when we're talking about live interaction. But I think students have a lot more agency in this format than they have in a room with a teacher. How often have you seen a student that's willing to stand up in the middle of a class, roll up their mat, and walk out of the room because they don't like what's going on? Very, very rare. Now, if you don't like what's going on, you can turn off your camera or you can turn the whole thing off. You can choose to not be seen. I've been teaching large groups using Zoom, and we encourage people. We say, look, this is the part of the class where myself and Lydia, who teaches with me, she has a very good eye for detail because she's an artist, as well as a skilled teacher. This is where we're going to be looking at you and offering you suggestions based on what we've seen. If you'd prefer not to be interacted with that way, turn off your camera. And at least a third of those little triangles goes dark. That's fantastic for me. I don't take that personally. I love seeing that because that's a student exercising their agency. It's like, you know what? I don't want to be seen. I can still see what's going on. I can still hear what's going on, but I don't want my camera to be on. I love when people do that, you know? And I think that's easier to do than flipping one of those no touch coins or whatever in a classroom, because you still feel there's like some group pressure. There's some, you know, whatever you want to fit in, you don't want to stand out kind of thing that that happens in an in-person experience. So this is never going to go away. This online stuff, you know, whether or not we ever feel comfortable being in a crowded room, breathing the same air and touching each other the way we did in the past, I don't know how long it's going to take for that to come back into our lives. But this is never going to go out of our lives because it's such a powerful way of extending your classroom to the rest of the world and giving people the kind of agency that may not be able to, that they may not feel they're able to exercise in an in-person experience. So I think it's very powerful, and I love that it's happening, that it's able to happen, that we're still able to do what we do when we can't be in rooms together with each other.
I think that's a great point. And what I would add to that is there are so many people that never went into the yoga school, Leslie, because they didn't want to put on the yoga clothes. They never went into the yoga school because they felt that they lacked some kind of a qualification in their appearance or maybe their confidence or their esteem.
Sure.
They didn't even go in. And now this, you know, group, this niche of students, they can watch it later, like alone, like a Netflix. They can be on a program, as you say, with their camera turned off, and they can participate regardless of what their the hesitations were that kept them out of a classroom.
100%. And there's students that were doing yoga now that would never have felt that they had access to it before. And there's teachers that have access to those students that would never have found them if they were just in a live space. In fact, I know some teachers who graduated their teacher training right as the pandemic hit, who have found their audience, and they've never taught a live class in their teaching lives, and maybe never will. They have found their audience. Wow. Their students have found their teacher, and it's all happening, you know, in this virtual space that this technology makes available. So, yeah.
Yeah. I don't know if you know this about me, but I actually coach yoga teachers on how to earn a living. And so I had gone back to school for executive coaching, and a lot of what I learned around executive coaching was very beneficial for me to apply to my one-on-one yoga relationships, private client relationships, and then also to cultivate wellness coaching and other type of coaching relationships based on facilitation. So I give these tools to yoga teachers so that they can cultivate steady income and steady relationships and relationships that continue to improve, to act on the goals of their students. But some of my, you know, students that I coach, yoga teachers, they also have schools. And I was like, right away, as the changes were coming down, I was like, is your school online yet? And they're like, well, I'm waiting to hear from the governor. I was like, get your school online now. Your students need you now more than ever. Transition, get, you know, make them comfortable with the technology, get on there right away. And so, you know, if we could say the students need yoga now more than ever, there are so many more people out there who are willing to look at yoga because the levels of anxiety and fear that they're living with are, you know, overwhelming.
Sure.
So I want to hear about how yoga anatomy, your million books sold, 23 languages translated into number one on Amazon for yoga books. And I know you had a partner in
It was number one. Used to be number one. Right now, Larry Payne is number one with Yoga for Over 50 for Dummies.
Great.
Yeah. Yeah. Great. And good for Larry, because that's his niche, you know. Everyone's getting older. And that's the number one book now. It was number one for a while. That came about because the publisher, my publisher, Human Kinetics, had a best-selling book which sold a million copies ages ago, and it's called Strength Training Anatomy by Frederick Delavier. And I was familiar with the book. I had it on my shelf, and it's a beautiful book that illustrates, you know, the traditional strength training exercises with beautifully illustrated real people showing their bodies, but it's also showing the muscles that are activated in the different exercises. And they saw that there was an opportunity to have a book like that in the yoga market. They saw the yoga market. And this was back in 2004 that they approached me. And I tried to explain to them that yoga is not strength training, that each asana is not about this or that muscle. And I don't know why I thought I should just write a proposal anyway, after I explained to them why it wasn't possible to write a book like that. But, you know, to my horror, they accepted the proposal. And before I knew it, I had an advance and a deadline and no idea how to write the fucking thing. I was just out of my mind. I just like, oh my God, I can't believe this. So that's when I made the very smart move of bringing Amy Matthews into the project, who was at the time, you know, co-running the breathing project with me. And so she's the one with all the letters after her name. She's a certified movement analyst. She was teaching at the Laban Institute. She has that kind of brain that can really break things down kinesiologically. And so she and I worked on a method of analyzing the poses. Also, I brought in an illustrator that was up to the task, who could actually produce the illustrations. And when I first saw the first drawings that came out of the photographs that we took, I just knew that that it was extraordinary, because no one had ever seen anything like that before. The closest to that was something that was already on the market, and that was the key muscles of yoga, that Ray Long's book. But that used computer-generated graphics. It was very abstract, in the sense that it wasn't any person in particular. It was just computer-generated skeletons and graphics like that. And that was certainly not the feeling we were going for. We were going for individuals. Like, these are real people with real proportions and real bodies doing asanas, and you could see who they were, right? And that was the same with Delavier's book. You know, these were real people being illustrated. And so the book, we finally finished the book after blowing several deadlines. It came out in 2007, and it just took off. And to everyone's surprise, especially the publisher, they got caught short on the first printing. And they had to very quickly bring more printings out. And it's become kind of a staple. And, you know,
it certainly we're is. Just now. Congratulations.
Yeah, we just now, thank you. We just now finished work on the third edition, which will be out next year. So, and it's horrifying. It's horrifying for Amy and I both to read the words that we wrote 10 years ago, which we know there's like a million copies of out there. And it's like, oh, we so don't want to say it this way anymore. And so we've done a real top to bottom sort of re-envisioning of this material from the standpoint of where we are now, having evolved our perspective, and we're very happy to be able to update it. So that'll be out hopefully sometime in 2021. Oh, to have that chance to revise it, yes, we are. But it's horrifying.
Yeah, that's a lot of editorial.
Think that there's all these copies.
A lot of editorial freedom. Yeah. Well, we'll be sure to let everyone know to get the third edition.
Yes. Well, don't stop from buying the second edition if it's on your wish list now, because you'll want to be able to compare the both of them, and that'll be
there's a link below this video. So please do buy the second edition, and certainly do buy the second edition if you don't have it. So what are you reading? What do you enjoy reading, or what do you, you know, what are you like engaging your mind into? What's inspiring for you in terms of if this is the right term, like personal growth or wisdom growing or something? What are you?
Well, interesting that along with the work on the third edition, which is winding to a close at the end of this month of November of 2020, because that's our like drop dead deadline. You know, there's deadlines and there's drop dead deadlines. And that's ours. The thing that's inspiring me the most book-wise is a book that has not actually been published yet, because it's a book I'm working on with a dear friend of mine. It's a novel. And I don't think I'm even allowed to say what the title of the novel is right now. It's his novel. It's his work. But I've been collaborating with him on some edits and some sort of clarifying of plot themes and various other aspects of the book that I can add value to. And it's really a joy to live in the universe he created for these characters. And takes place in the past, and it's focused on music and musicians and the struggles they face against cultural trends that were present back then. I can't say more about it because I'm not allowed to, but I'll be sure to let you know when there's a copy available. And it's there's an added dimension for me to this ability to live in the universe that someone creates with a really good novel. And I've had that experience reading certain novels that have been very influential in the past. You know, I mean, I remember picking up Atlas Shrugged and losing two nights of sleep because I didn't want to put it down. I mean, that's like not wanting to leave that universe, you know? And I've had that experience with this novel several times through in its development and having the added dimension of contributing to its development. So that's the thing that's really getting me very excited right now in terms of what's nourishing me and engaging me creatively, and something that I think a lot of people are going to enjoy when this book finally comes out. So, and my name won't be on it. It'll be in it in an acknowledgement, but it's his book. It's totally his book. It's his universe. It's his characters. It's his plot. And I'm just really happy that I'm able to add some value to it, because I love living in that world he made.
You asked your teacher, what did he think was the future of yoga in the West, Desikachar, and he said, "I'm not from the West. That's up to the Western people." But he did say something, and I don't want to paraphrase it. I would leave it up to you to paraphrase it. But he said, "Anyone who's concerned about the future of man," meaning I think humankind, the future of man, can position the future of yoga, because the future of humankind and yoga have a tight relationship there.
Yes, that was how we ended that interview, because the context of what he said was that the pretext for having the conversation in the first place was that I invited him to this conference that I was helping to produce in 1993, which was the 100th anniversary of yoga in America, Unity in Yoga. Did you go? Were you at that one?
I was not at it.
Okay. Yeah.
But I was the recipient of all of these cassette tapes.
Yes.
They came out of the conference. And
did you notice who produced the cassette tapes? Who produced the cassette tapes?
I imagine you did.
No. Actually,
was it?
That's how Sounds True got started.
Right.
Yes. Sounds True originally started as a company that would go into a live event and record the event and do high speed cassette duplication on site for people that wanted a record of the event to take home with them. That was how Sounds True got started as a company. And we used them, the Unity and Yoga used them to make those cassettes. Yeah.
So you were interviewing Desikachar around an invitation.
Yeah, in lieu of the invitation, basically he politely declined the invitation to travel to the States the following year and be at this conference. Turns out it's a good thing he wasn't there for a variety of reasons, but we did the interview instead. And so I asked him if you could say something to the audience at that event about the future of yoga, what would you say? And that's where he said, well, who am I to say what the future of yoga is in the West? I'm not from the West, I'm from Madras. I think for people that are concerned about the future of yoga in the West, like you, Leslie, he pointed to me, it's in the hands of those people that are concerned about the future of yoga. And more than that, because yoga has to do with the betterment of mankind, people who are concerned about the betterment of mankind, if the conversation is in their hands, then it's in good hands. And so that's pretty much how he left the task to us. And so he was not one of these people who would say, oh, you Westerners, you're ruining it. The only authentic yoga is Indian yoga taught by Indians. He didn't have that perspective, which sadly his son seems to have. Because he's put out, you know, information about how, you know, yoga has become so superficial and all of that. And Westerners are basically ruining it and they need to get back to the roots and so on. And I found it necessary to actually quote his father back at him in an article I wrote in rebuttal to a letter that he put out there several years ago. And so that was the specific quote that I used, the one that you reference as well. Yeah.
I mean, in terms of like the yogi being like a radical and very aware of the self and agency, you are a fierce, you know, spokesperson for yoga, which I completely applaud and admire. And you really bring a lot of, you know, knowledge and grit and passion, as well as, you know, wisdom and training and experience to speaking out on yoga. So what would you tell like yoga people that are listening now, or yoga teachers, yoga students, or say yoga teachers, a certain amount of a mantle on their shoulders for caretaking and looking after yoga for today and the future? What would you say to us, Leslie, or what would you say to those listeners? What is the future of yoga? How can we participate?
Well, I don't think, first of all, yoga is fine. It's going to be okay. I don't think we can ruin it because it's not a thing. You know, it's not like some precious artifact that you keep in a museum and you have to climate control it so the thing doesn't, you know, degrade, right? It's a living, breathing practice and discipline that those of us that have benefited from it occasionally want to share with other people and become teachers. And so however we choose to do it is fine. And I'm not one of these people that has a problem with the word yoga getting stuck alongside other words like goat or dog
or butt,
you know, or butt. Yeah, well, I'm the one who started yoga butt, but it was a diagnosis of something that goes wrong with your body, not the way you look in yoga pants, right? but the idea that anyone can ruin yoga, or on the other hand, that someone needs to be the spokesperson for yoga on behalf of other people. To me, it betrays a deep misunderstanding of what yoga is. Yoga is something that lives on a moment-to-moment basis in how we re-inhabit our bodies, how we recognize the falsehood of the dichotomy between our minds and souls and our bodies. And so however we choose to share that is fine. If the promise of doing yoga with your dog or a goat or a pig is what takes to get someone to get on their mat, then fine. As long as at some point, somebody's going to ask you to move and breathe your body in a certain way that engages your mind in this integrated experience of yourself, that's the payoff. Whatever flavoring you need to put on top of that to induce someone into that experience, for me, is that's just a function of the free market. And, you know, I think anyone should presume to dictate what anyone can do in that free market of ideas and offerings in the name of yoga. So share from your own sense of connection what worked for you, what transformed your life. As long as it's yours and not some regurgitated stuff that you just assemble from undigested pieces of information, you know, make it something authentic that you've digested. It's become part of yourselves. And then it'll be something that will attract the right students for you. And on the student side, it's the same thing, you know, whatever draws you in is fine. It's the beginning of a journey, and wherever that journey takes you, is your journey and no one else's. And it sounds like platitudes when you say it that way, but it's really true. And I wouldn't presume to speak for anyone other than myself in this regard. And that's what it's been for me, certainly, just following my interest and following that thread that leads me from one thing to another. And I've been very, very fortunate to have worked with and learned from some extraordinary people over the years. And I continue to learn, you know, mostly from my students and the people that come in and are attracted to what I'm doing. And Desikachar said the same thing about when his father died, you know, all he had to do was focus on him and an answer would be there. But mainly he was learning from his students. And I can really relate to that now that I've been doing this for over 40 years. So it's a long-winded answer, but you know, he asked me about something I'm passionate about and that's what you're gonna get.
I think that you said, you know, you had this interest, and it absolutely begins with the interest of having an interest in yoga. And that interest through who we meet and who we share the yoga with can shape our entire life and our entire journey of going from pillar to post or following that thread. And you've also, you know, over these many decades of yoga discovery, you've had an incredible community and, you know, people that have been alongside you in the teachings and on the mat and the experience, you know, in these yoga experiences. So that benefits the whole community.
Yeah, and I love that you're doing these interviews, because in a way it's showing us that all of us that were part of it at a certain time and place are part of that community, you know, you and me and Dana and Cindy. And, you know, I could list off a whole bunch of people that passed through that whole East Village, Jiva Mukti, New York scene in the late 80s, early to mid 90s, you know, and just the waves of connection and influence that spread out from her. I mean, think of, you know, where would Krishnadas have gone to chant if it weren't for Jiva Mukti, right? You know, back
Amazing.
In 94. Yeah, right? And think of all of that, yeah.
I had... you know, moved to Los Angeles in 94, but I came back, I think, for Ruth's wedding. And she said, everyone said, oh, well, we have to go to Jiva Mukti on Monday. This guy Krishnadas is chanting. I was like, who's Krishnadas? You know, cut ahead a year. Right. I've opened a yoga school in Los Angeles. Krishnadas is a friend of mine. And I said, if you ever come to California, come to my yoga school. So the very first time he performed in Los Angeles was at my yoga school, tiny storefront on Sunset Boulevard. I was teaching at Yoga Works. I was teaching at a place called Angel City Yoga. I taught at Larchmont, the big yoga school there. Sure. And I invited everyone I knew. I was like, this cannot be missed. This cannot be missed. As Krishnadas likes to say, there were 11 people there, but, you know, it was amazing. Over the next year, there was a line over the block, around the block. Sure. And then I introduced him. I was at Yoga Works one day, and they had a great store there, and they were playing Krishnadas. And Chuck was kind of humming along. I was like, Chuck, do you like this guy? And he goes, yeah. I said, do you want to present him here for, you know, a concert or for a budget? And he was like, well, I don't know if our people will really like it. But they were doing a big fundraiser. So they presented Krishnadas sort of within the fundraiser. And of course, he lit the town on fire. But
yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, I know. Yeah, and Shamdas.
I have one little, yeah, Shamdas, sure. Can't, and you know, Jiva was sponsoring Jayutal before Krishnadas ever showed up, right? So they were, and Bhagavan Das. Don't forget, yes. Bhagavan Das was there as
Bhagavan.
Well.
Bhagavan.
And so, yeah, my one little regret is that I missed about 10 years worth of friendship with KD, because when Jiva started having rules about who taught there and that you had to come to satsang if you wanted to teach there, I was like, you know, sorry, if you had invited me to come to satsang and said, you know, we'll even let you lead the chanting, I would have been there in a hot minute. But as soon as you make that a rule, you know, I'm like out of here. And David offered to make an exception for me. And I said, no, sorry, this is the kind of place that you're turning it into. It's gonna have rules like that. You gotta stick to the rules. And so that was like early in 94 that I stopped teaching there. And it was later on that year that KD showed up and started chanting. If only they had just invited me to come to a satsang, I'd have probably been there when KD first showed up. And I, you know, knowing how good friends we are now, we would have hit it off then as well and had 10 extra years to our friendship. But water under the bridge. It was the right time for us to leave. And Uma left as well. We were about to have our first child and we started our own place. And that was a whole other story. But yeah.
Leslie, we have spoke for hours. And I know that I could continue to speak to you. And the fact that you came to meet me when you're on your dead drop, what's it called? When your book is due, your third edition is due, and you took time out to speak with me. Thank you so much. I look forward to sharing this. I'm going to share a lot of what we touched on in links below this. I will share everything about you, but why don't you just share it now if people want to, the quickest way that people can find
The quickest way to get in touch is,
sure.
The quickest way is just to go to my personal website, which is in the process of being rebuilt by Lydia, who is now in the room over there, thinking, yeah,
hi, Lydia.
We really need to get that website.
The very technically capable Lydia.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. Yeah. But the website is yogaanatomy.org. Yogaanatomy.org. And it's two A's, yogaanatomy.org. And there's links to the online courses and my blog and like basically everything I'm doing there. And that'll be the portal for all things Leslie. So yeah, that's how to find me.
Great. Leslie, thank you so much. We will continue to be in touch, and be well to you and your whole family and your clan there, and to be continued.
All right. Okay, keep sailing. I'm glad to hear you're out on the water having fun.
Yes, as I said at the beginning, I think before we turned on the recording, I am living on a sailboat and traveling the coastal United States, and it's very exciting. But I'm going to turn off this recording, but I want you to stay right there. Thank you for joining me today.